بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome you all beta in distant learning regarding carry on your lectures. Be safe at home, wash your hands, be safe from the corona. So today I will discuss with you lymphedema. So regarding the definition, it is defined as abnormal lymph swelling which is caused by accumulation of increased amount of high protein interstitial fluid. This accumulation is because of the defective lymphatic drainage in the presence of normal net capillary filtration or near normal net capillary filtration. Regarding the scope of clinical problem or epidemiology, at birth 1 in 6,000 people they will develop lymphedema. Overall prevalence is 0.13 to 2%. And because it leads to the emotional and psychological distress, so it can lead to the difficulties with relationships, education and work. And it is also misdiagnosed and mistreated by the doctors because of the poor understanding of the importance of condition, believing it to be primarily a cosmetic problem in early stages. The severity of unilateral lymphedema is classified as mild, moderate and severe based on excess lymph volume. If it is less than 20%, classified as mild, and in moderate 20 to 40% of excess lymph volume, and in severe cases more than 40% excess lymph volume. We classify lymphedema into two types, primary lymphedema and secondary lymphedema. In primary lymphedema, the cause is unknown etiology, and it is thought to be caused by the congenital lymphatic dysplasia, and in secondary are acquired, there is a clearly underlying cause is present. Primary lymphedema further subdivided into the three types because on the basis of presence of family history, age of onset and lymphangiographic findings into congenital, precox and tarda. In congenital type, the onset is less than 2 years of age. It's and sporadic and familial cases are there, which are also known as Milroy disease, non-Milroy disease, and precox, that is onset between 2 to 35 years of age, sporadic cases, and familial also. In familial, it is known as Meigs disease, and tarda, that is onset after 35 years of age. Regarding the etiology of secondary lymphedema, it is caused by the various etiologies, various causes are there, like parasitic infection, filariasis, fungal infection caused by Tinea pedis, and exposure to the foreign body material like silica particles, primary lymphatic malignancy, metastasis to the lymph nodes, radiotherapy to the lymph nodes, surgical excision of the lymph nodes, trauma, superficial thrombophlebitis, and deep vein thrombosis. Clinical classification of the lymphedema on the basis of different presentations, different sign and symptoms. So we classify on the basis of Brunner grading, that is into subclinical, that is latent type, then type 1 or grade 1, grade 2 and grade 3. So in subclinical or latent grade, the clinical features are because there is excess interstitial fluid and histological abnormalities are in lymphatics and lymph nodes. And there is no clinically apparent lymphedema. Is there only just increased amount of interstitial fluid? It is latent. That's why it is subclinical. And in grade 1, edema, that is pitting edema. And if we elevate the limb and having a bed rest, so this swelling largely or completely disappears. And in grade 2, it's non-pitting edema. And there is no reduction in the swelling upon elevation with positive stammer sign. And in grade 3, edema is associated with irreversible skin changes, that is fibrosis and papillae formations. Now, there are different risk factors regarding upper and lower lymphedema. So in this slide, we will talk about the risk factors for upper limb or trunk lymphedema. So various causes are there, like surgery with X-ray lymph node dissection, particularly if extensive breast or lymph node surgery is done, scar formation, fibrosis and radiodermatitis because of the post-operative axillary radiotherapy. And if radiotherapy is given to the breast or to the axilla, to internal mammary or subclavicular lymph nodes, It's also because of the drain or wound complications, seroma formation, advanced cancer, obesity, congenital predispositions, and hypertension, taxane chemotherapy, insertion of the pacemakers, air travel. Regarding the risk factors for the lower limb lymphedema, surgery with inguinal lymph node dissection in various like pelvic malignancies and postoperative radiotherapy given because of the pelvic malignancies, recurrent soft tissue infection at the same site, obesity is varicose vein surgery, that is stripping and vein harvesting leads to lymphedema formation, and advanced cancers, orthopedic surgery, poor nutritional status, and so on. So the pathophysiology, regarding the pathophysiology, first we need to know about the total amount of the fluid produced in interstitial fluid, that is around 10 to 12 liters in an average 70 kg man, and this is about 50% of the wet weight of skin and subcutaneous tissue. And if edema has to be clinically detectable, this volume should be doubled, like 20 to 24 liters. And total lymph production is 8 liters in the interstitial fluid, and it travels each day and from different lymphatics to the lymph nodes, and from the lymph nodes the volume remains around the half before it enters into the venous circulation. So in one sense, all edema is lymphedema, in that it results from inability of the lymphatic system to clear interstitial fluid compartment. In majority cases of edema, if we talk about if we review the anatomy of the lymphatics, that it's from the like arteries, arterioles, capillaries, then venules and veins, and then major veins, and in between there's interstitial fluid. So capillary filtration rate at the level of the capillaries, this is pathologically high, and this overwhelms a normal lymphatic system. So because its capillary filtration rate is high, low in the lymphatic system, so more fluid is taken up by the lymphatics, and resulting accumulation is a low protein rich edema fluid. But in true lymph edema, because of the problem lies in the lymphatics, in this case capillary filtration rate is normal, but edema fluid is relatively high in protein because there is no passage of the fluid in the lymphatics because of the problem lies in the lymphatics. So this lymphedema results from the lymphatic aplasia, hypoplasia, dysmotility, obliteration of the lymphatics by inflammatory, infective, or neoplastic or surgical procedures. So what happened? It results in physical or function, because of the physical or functional obstruction of the lymphatics, accumulation of the lymph fluid is there, that is lymphostasis, leads to the lymphatic hypertension, increased pressure and distension of the lymphatics, and this leads to the further impairment of contractility and valves in the lymphatics. So it leads to increased fluid in interstitial fluid compartment, proteins, growth factors, glycosaminoglycans and bacteria. This whole process results in increased collagen production by the fibroblast and accumulation of inflammatory cells, predominantly macrophages and lymphocytes, and keratinocytes activation. So end result is protein-rich edema fluid, increased deposition of ground substance, subdermal fibrosis, dermal thickening and proliferation. And regarding the location locality, the lymph edema, unlike the other types, it is confined to the epiphyseal space. So lymph edema mainly have presentation or involvement of the foot, and contour of the ankle is lost through infilling of submalleolar depression. It is also known as Buffalo hump. This forms on the dorsum of the foot, and also the toes appear square because of confinement of footwear, and skin on the dorsum of toes cannot be pinched because of the subcutaneous fibrosis, that is Tamer sign. Lymphedema, this usually spreads proximal to the knee level and less commonly involves the whole leg, And in early stages, it is pitting edema, and the patient reports that swelling is down in the morning because of the bed rest and some limb elevation. So this is a reversible component to the swelling, which can be controlled at this level. And here you can see in this slide, skin changes like chronic eczema, fungal infection, that is dermatophytosis, and nails, that is onychomycosis, fissuring, papillae formation, ulceration is unusual except in the presence of chronic venous insufficiency. And also there's lymphangiomas. These are dilated dermal lymphatics that blister onto the skin surface when fluid, they leak the fluid, and the fluid that's leaking is usually clear, but it can be the blood stained. We classify these lymphangiomas on the basis of the size into three types. Lymphangiomas circumscriptum, that is less than 5 cm across, and lymphangiomas diffusum, if they are more widely or more widespread, and lymphedema abagni, if they form a reticulate pattern of ridges, then it has been termed this one. They frequently weep, and they weep lymphoria, chyloria, causing skin maceration, and they act as a portal of infection, then causing protein losing diarrhea, chylesocytes, chylothorax formation if it's in the thoracic cavity, chylurea if it's leaking through the urine, and discharge from the lymphangioma, this just lymphangiectasia and chylus reflex. Some malignancies are also associated with lymphedema, like lymphangiosarcoma, that is Stewart-Travis syndrome after modified radical mastectomy for the CA breast, and Kaposi sarcoma in case of human HIV, squamous cell carcinoma, liposarcoma, malignant melanoma, malignant fibrous histiocytoma, basal cell carcinoma, and lymphoma. Symptoms frequently experienced by the patients, various types of the presentation. Patient can present with the swelling and having, they have a history that clothing or jewelry, it's becoming tighter. And also there's a pain that is initially constant dull pain, and it can be the severe burning and bursting sensations, tiredness, sensitivity to the heat, pins and needles, cramps. They have skin problems like weeping, excoriation, breakdown, immobility, backache, joint problems, athlete's foot. They have different combination of presentation, it can be there. So now I will discuss with you the primary lymphedema. Etiology, it can be due to an inherited abnormality of the lymphatic system, also known as congenital lymphatic dysplasia. And many sporadic cases, they occur in the presence of normal lymphatic system or near normal lymphatic system. They are actually examples of secondary lymphedema for which the triggering events are gone unrecognized. Primary lymphedema is classified, as we already discussed, that on the basis of genetic susceptibility, age of onset, and lymphangiographic findings. So first we will discuss genetic susceptibility. It can be familial or sporadic. In familial cases, the gene mutations, it can be inherited in like autosomal dominant, recessive, or X-linked pattern. And so far, mutations in more than 20 genes have been linked to the development of primary lymphedema. And in familial mutations in an individual penetrance of the lymphedema, this can often be incomplete, leading to a large variability in clinical presentation. There can be involvement of other systems also, like cardiovascular, respiratory, nervous, and digestive system. In this slide, we can have we can see different affected genes leading to unique clinical signs, and also lymphoscintigraphic findings like FMS. This is like tyrosine kinase gene, and leading to non-amyloid disease, isolated low lymphedema. That is present at the birth. It's also known as lymphedema, congenital lymphedema, and scintigraphic finding that's functional aplasia, failure of initial lymphatic absorption, and So many are there, like vascular endothelial growth factor C, that is Milroy-like disease, and also you can see gap junction protein gamma 2, gap junction protein alpha 1. So different factor genes with having unique clinical signs, and also they have lymphoscintigraphic findings are there. According to the age of onset, so congenital lymphedema less than 2 years of age, and 10 to 25% of all primary lymphedema is the incidence. It can be sporadic or familial. In familial, it is known as Milroy disease, as we have just discussed. In familial cases, it's FMS like tyrosine kinase gene deficiency. It's more common in the males, and the lower extremity involved 3 times more frequently than the upper. And 2/3 patients have bilateral lymphedema and aplasia pattern without subcutaneous lymphatic trunk involvement. And lymphedema precox, that is evident after birth and before 35 years of age, so between 2 to 35 years of age incidence. And most often arises during the puberty. 65 to 80% of all lymphedema cases are in incidence in lymphedema precox. Females are more affected, 4 times more affected. 70% of cases, they are unilateral, with the left lower limb extremity being involved. And hypoplastic pattern is there, with the lymphatics reduced in the number and the caliber. And lymphedema tarda, that is Meigs disease. Clinically, it's not evident until 35 years or older than that. And this is the rarest form of the lymphedema. Only 10% of cases are there. And this has hyperplastic pattern with the tortuous lymphatics. They increased in the caliber and number, with absent or incompetent valves there, as you can see in these pictures. So on the basis of lymphangiographic classification, we have here age of onset, sex distribution, extent, laterality, family history, progression, and response to the compression therapy, and the regarding the comments on the findings, on the x-rays, on the study. So in cases of congenital hyperplasia, that is 10%, in distal obliteration 80%, and proximal obliteration 10%. We see in the next slide also. So age of onset in congenital is like the congenital, and in distal, if distal obliteration is there, so it's puberty, like precox, that is between 2 to 35 years of age, and 10% at any age in case of proximal obliteration. So in regarding the sex distribution, males are more common in congenital, and in distal obliteration females are more having more distribution, and with proximal obliteration, both male and female, they are the same. So extent in congenital hyperplasia, whole of the leg is involved, and in distal obliteration, ankle and half is involved, and if proximal obliteration, then whole leg, thigh only. In laterality, unilateral and bilateral, it's around the same. In distal obliteration, this is often bilateral, and in proximal obliteration, usually unilateral. And family history, positive, often positive in cases of congenital hyperplasia, and often, and also in distal obliteration, but there's no family history in case of proximal obliteration. So in congenital hyperplasia, the lymphatics, they are increased in number, they have increased in caliber, so but functionally defective. So there is usually an increased number of lymph nodes, and they may have chylocystitis, chylothorax, and protein losing enteropathy. In distal obliteration, absent or reduced distal superficial lymphatics, so they are also termed as aplasia or hypoplasia. And in proximal obliteration, obstruction at the level of aortoiliac or inguinal lymph node level. So if associated with distal dilatation, the patient may benefit from the lymphatic bypass operation. So in this slide, you can see the normal pattern of the lymphatics. Then congenital hyperplasia, here you can see that whole of the right side, along with thoracic duct and paraaortic lymph nodes, they all are dilated. And in cases of distal obliteration, that is hypoplasia, you can see on the left side, the distal is obliterated, and the proximal, that is thigh and inguinal and femoral, they have dilated vessels. And in cases of proximal obliteration, the distal, all the distal bilateral lymphatics are dilated, And proximal obliteration with the hypoplasia or aplasia, you can also see that left sided dilated lymphatics are there. Regarding the secondary lymphedema, this is the most common form of the lymphedema, and there are several well recognized causes that includes infection, inflammation, neoplasia, and trauma. We will discuss one by one with them, like in trauma and tissue damage, like lymph node excision, radiotherapy given to the lymph nodes, burns, patient varicose vein surgery, and scarring in different malignant diseases. In cases of lymph node metastasis, like carcinoma breast, infiltrative carcinoma, lymphoma, and in different venous diseases like chronic venous insufficiency, venous ulceration, different infections are there, different inflammatory conditions like rheumatoid arthritis, dermatitis, psoriasis, endocrine and diseases that lead to the pre-tibial myxedema. And so filariasis, this is the most common form of the lymphedema worldwide that affects up to that 10 million individuals. It's more prevalent in Africa, India, and South America, and 5 to 10% of the total population may be affected. It is caused by viviparous nematode, that is Wuchereria bancrofti, and only host is the man. So it's responsible 90% of the cases, and the mode of spread is through mosquitoes, and it's also associated with poor sanitation. The parasites, they enter the lymphatics from the blood, and they site in the lymph nodes where it causes the fibrosis and obstruction due partly to the direct physical damage and partly to the immune response to the host. And proximal lymphatics, they become dilated with adult parasites. So degree of edema in such cases is massive, as you can see in the slide, and it also known as elephantiasis. How we manage this patient? Regarding the investigations, immature parasites, they usually enter the blood at night, so they can be identified on a blood smear, in a centrifuge specimen of urine or lymph itself. It can be identified in the blood or in urine or lymph itself. So, and there's also complement fixation test that is available, and it's positive in present or past infection and also eosinophilia. It is usually treated by diethyl carbamazepine that destroyed parasites, but it does not reverse lymphatic changes. And once infection is clear, treatment is as with the primary lymphedema with lifestyle modification. So public health measures has to be taken to reduce, like mosquito breeding, protective clothing, and mosquito nets that may be usually employed to combat the condition. And endemic elephantiasis, that is podoconiosis, it is common in the tropic countries, and it affects more than 500,000 people in Africa. It is caused by the barefoot cultivation of the soil composed of alkaline volcanic rocks that leads to the destruction of peripheral lymphatics by the particles of silica, and also seen macrophages in the draining lymph nodes. There is a plantar edema that develops in the childhood, and rapidly this spreads proximally. This condition is can be prevented, and its progression is slowed down by wearing of shoes. Also, secondary lymphedema is caused by the bacterial infection, that is lymphangitis, lymphadenitis. They usually lead to the lymphatic destruction and causing lymphedema, which is complicated by further acute inflammatory episodes. And interestingly, in such patients, lymphangiography has revealed abnormalities in contralateral unaffected limb also, suggesting underlying possible inherited susceptibility. So lymphatic and lymph node destruction by the tuberculosis, that's a bacterial infection, is a well recognized cause of the lymphedema in resource poor countries. Malignancy and its treatment, like carcinoma breast, and surgery treatment is done with surgery or radiotherapy, leads to the lymphedema. It is also known as Stewart-Travis lymphedema of the patient, that is a malignant condition. Lymphoma can also present with the lymphedema, and Kaposi sarcoma in cases of HIV patients. Trauma leads to secondary lymphedema. Etiology is multifactorial. That includes disuse, venous thrombosis, and lymphatic injury or destruction. So degloving injuries and burns, they particularly likely to disrupt dermal lymphatics. If there is a tenosynovitis, this can be associated with localized subcutaneous lymphedema, which can be a cause of troublesome persistent swelling following ankle and wrist sprains. And regarding lymphedema and chronic venous insufficiency, it is important to differentiate between lymphedema and chronic venous insufficiency because they are relatively common and so often coexist in the same patient. Certainly, the test for the venous function like duplex ultrasonography, plethysmography, they are frequently abnormal also in cases or in patients with lymphedema. And if surgery is done in such patients having both chronic venous insufficiency and lymphedema, so there are certain drawbacks because surgery invariably failed to reveal the swelling, relieve the swelling. Swelling is no more relieved after the surgery for varicose veins or for chronic venous insufficiency. And usually it make worse more as saphenofemoral and saphenopopliteal ligation together with saphenous stripping, and this further compromise drainage through the subcutaneous lymph bundles and the draining inguinal and popliteal lymph nodes. So this is all about regarding lymphedema. If you have any queries, any questions, I will appreciate and to answer your questions. Thank you. Allah Hafiz.